Good evening, everyone. We're very lucky this evening to have Dan Stubbergaard from COBE come to present to us. Housing and urbanism's reasons for inviting Dan go back a few years. We took a program study trip to Malmö and Copenhagen, and one of our colleagues, Elad Eisenstein, said, "Oh, we've got to go see some of the work that COBE has done." And the more we explored their work, the more we were inclined to agree with Elad's initial sense, which was that they were a practice that had managed to cross the scales very, very delightfully in a way that we appreciate very much in housing and urbanism, that they're able to find things in the detail that are really worth exploring as a pathway into a larger series of effects within the city. Now, when we went to visit the practice, they were just in the process of guiding and shepherding one of their projects for Nørreport, which is a new sort of station area above ground for an underground stop on the metro system. And what was interesting about this was that they were recognizing that this whole scheme had to be understood as the interaction between different modes of transport and the way in which people think about how they use bicycles and how they get off their bicycles, park them, go underground, and get into the metro system. And the way in which they understood this showed a capacity to reason across these multiple modes of transport, these different approaches to, in a way, being an urban subject with a different kind of hat on at different moments in time. And the solution they came up with was something where, in a way, you might almost miss it as you walk through the city because it was just so natural. And that was, in fact, what they had aimed for, an understanding of really how we inhabit, learn about a city, move through the city in such a way that we are able to envision a different architecture, because the actual solution that they came up with was very, very different than the way in which people were designing their approaches to these kinds of stations and their approach to parking bicycles and the way in which people move through the city. Now, it's not surprising to me then that COBE's practice has gone from strength to strength, and their projects are being are popping up in North America, further away in Scandinavia and throughout Europe. And it's also not surprising to me that our students are continually finding inspiration in their work, because it shows a kind of simultaneously of what we think of as a relatively light touch to architecture, nothing too ostentatious, but there's always something special about the approach. At the same time that there's this kind of light touch, there's a clarity to the projects that we find in a way very moving. So we were delighted when Dan accepted the invitation in a very busy schedule to come over and spend a few hours with us and tell us more about the way in which they are thinking about a range of projects, from relatively small projects to actually fairly large master planning projects. So Dan, we're delighted that you come to talk to us tonight. Thanks.
Great, Lawrence. Thank you. Wonderful. It's great to be here. I brought my Danish lumber to keep my identity as a Nordic noir person. I don't know if you're still watching Danish crime series on BBC, but also I think we are also maybe, how do you say, becoming recognized for something more than food culture and Nordic noir and TV series. There's a big interest regarding design and architecture again towards Denmark, which is a fantastic thing as well. Now we need to get the technical part working again. This is my coat.
It's just like mine.
just, I will, my lecture is going to be titled Our Urban Living Room, and it's based on a book we published, and it's going to be a second edition is going to be out here in May again. But I just want to do a brief introduction to our office and what we are actually, how we work, but in a way also what keeps us engaged and interested into architecture as well. When I founded COBE 11 years ago, so we are, I don't know whether we are still young or becoming old, I'm 43 years old, but 11 years is a long duration of hard work, but it's also incredibly short at the same time. But we founded COBE in an idea that architecture is a lot more than just beautiful design. It's a lot more than form, but it's actually how can we improve the quality of for people living in our cities? How can we create social interaction and empower architecture to have a much broader role regarding something more than the field of architecture and the language of architecture, how we normally speak among each other as well. So how can architecture actually improve the quality for places, communities, and social interaction in our cities? That's something, if I should make an umbrella of our work, something we have been interested in doing the last 11 years. Our office is located in Copenhagen. I'm also born in Copenhagen. This is our kind of, Copenhagen is our laboratory, so to say. We are an office of 110 architects now. So from being small, becoming a little bit bigger, and now we are a medium-sized office, and that's very challenging, but also very exciting. But I often bring these images as well, because that's actually my heritage somehow, how I grew up. And also I think that's the key role why I became an architect. That is the playfulness of playing with Lego. Lego is a Danish kind of a product, it's part of our Danish culture. But it's about having a tool for creativity, but it's also a tool which can guide you into making form to a complex matter. It's also a tool which can be a small detail, but it can also be, you can build a large city as well. And the intuition of Lego is something I actually really love. That is that it's a toy, but it's also a building block where you can involve people in a way as well. And that is what we want architecture to become as well. We want to involve people, not only in our profession, but much broader, and make people interested in architecture, not to say again, because people are. But I think if we as a profession need to survive in the future, we need to enlarge the way we communicate and involve people much more. So people, on a broad sense, understand the impact of good architecture and also maybe the impact of bad architecture as well. And Lego is really a tool where you can make people involved, and they can build, they can play, they can actually come with answers to architecture as well. So that's actually our vision, to involve people in the building of architecture, and involving people in how we can come up with solutions for the better city. As Lawrence mentioned, we are a studio which is very much focused on all scales of architecture. We do urban planning, we do large scale projects, we do buildings, architecture, and also public spaces and landscape. It sounds very kind of, okay, we want to do everything, but we believe very strongly that if you have a knowledge and an interest in the large scale, you also can come up with maybe a different answer on small scale interventions as well. So the playfulness of scale is something we are very interested in our office. So let's start with the big scale somehow. This picture is taken from the Apollo mission in 1974, which that was also the year I was born. Which was this capture of the planet, which was really unique, this green and blue unique planet in the universe. And I think as a profession, this is also what we are facing currently 43 years later. That is, if we continue inhabiting and in a way using our planet as we have learned to do, we are exhausting the resources of our planet, and we are in a very much in a very challenging situation as well. So I think we have a significant role as designers, architects, planners, landscape designers, to help guiding towards a more sustainable way of how we build and how we inhabit the planet, and how we can create great cities to live in as well. 2030, there's going to be more than 10 billion people living on the planet. And how are we going to actually design for that challenge? That's one question. And of course, the cities has a huge role. In 2010, you can say the balance changed, and now there's more people living in urban areas than in rural areas. And the growth of the city is having a huge impact. These kind of mega cities, and how do you actually work with that? And of course, I'm from Scandinavia. We don't have mega cities, and I feel it's so funny landing in London. When I come to London, I feel so cute as a person. I'm from this kind of a small Scandinavian mid-sized city with a. I think there's like 600,000 people living in the core of Copenhagen, and then going to London, and then I really feel like, wow, I'm part of something bigger. So I have this kind of cuteness is part of my heritage, and also in a way that the Scandinavian approach is maybe quite different compared to other places in the world where you are challenged with much larger challenges as well. But I think there's something you can learn from, for instance, the Scandinavian way of thinking urbanism, thinking welfare architecture, which could be applied to a larger scale as well. So this is what we are facing as a profession as well. How can we improve the livability and the quality in these mega cities? How do we actually design, and how do we plan, and how do we actually create quality in this kind of urban forest in our cities as well? And this is something I'm also very interested in. How can we actually work with social integration and not social segregation? How can we actually create really good cities for everybody? Not only the rich, not only the poor, but how can you actually create social interaction in our cities as well? And of course, the question of mobility, how do you actually commute in our cities? What is a sustainable approach for the future as well? How do you move around in our cities as well? And how can you actually also create cities where you can feel individual, where you have your own opportunity, and the city becomes, you can say, diverse, creative place for a whole range of possibilities as well. And some of these questions, in a very humble way, I would like to address through some of our projects. And we had the opportunity last year to do an exhibition at the Danish Architecture Center. And at the same time, we wrote our first book. It was crazy. Never do it. It's so much work. You lose a lot of money, and you have no. I'm not an author. It was like a terrible process. But you have to do it somehow, I think, because it's something you compel things, and you can also kind of by writing try to communicate in a different way as an architect as well. Just the title was like, it was like a nightmare to come up with, like, what should we call this book? But we ended up with finding this term, our urban living room, which is having something about like our is about like it's more than just yourself. It's a community, and living room is about like that. It's about livability, but it's also about this kind of personal feeling of a nice, cozy living room. And that ended with this kind of blue book, which was like our way of compelling 10 years of work in the office, but also telling a story about our city, which is Copenhagen, the city where our office is located, and our involvement in the in the development of the small city or the cute city of Copenhagen, and how we have contributed to the development of that city as well. And this is a picture I took 2 years ago, which is actually this kind of eager to move your living room out into the city, actually to take part of the city, that the city has so many qualities that you actually are so keen on it that you take your couch and move it out in the city rather than staying at home. And this is also an image telling the story of a city which had an industrial harbor, and now it was cleaned up. You can swim in it without it being unhealthy. And this idea that if the city is a livable city, actually you'd rather prefer to be out in the city taking part of a social life rather than sitting home in your own living room. And that was some of the kind of readings of the city we wanted to take, and also see in a way how some of our projects, which we have been doing in the city of Copenhagen, have been helping towards creating maybe a more livable city as well. Copenhagen is also a city which have been transforming from a dull, I don't know, I'm 43, I grew up in the city. It is like London, a city which have changed so much the last 20 years time. And Copenhagen is also rated as one of the most livable cities in the world through magazines. And that was actually, this is a nice drawing I somehow like to show. This was how Copenhagen as a city was perceived for many, many years. We had the Little Mermaid, which was the main tourist attraction, which made people coming to the city. But it also, as a city, had a little bit difficulties to compete with the big icons, the real icons as well. So when people go to Copenhagen and they see the Little Mermaid, they get a little bit disappointed due to the fact of the size of the sculpture. Some tourists, they call the Danish tourist agency and ask whether how to book a table in the restaurant in the face or the head of the Little Mermaid. So somehow this was what Copenhagen was famous for many years. But the last 10, 15 years, the city have changed rapidly towards something much more, and maybe something much more interesting as well. Because now it's not really the Little Mermaid or Tivoli Gardens, which is famous anymore. It's actually people go to Copenhagen to see how we have organized our everyday life and see how we, in a way, have an everyday life city. So biking is taking over the Little Mermaid's role. And this is what people really find interesting going to visit the city. It's actually just how we, for instance, have organized the city regarding green mobility and the biking culture of the city as well. This is one of the main bicycle routes, especially in the summertime. It's really crazy how many people is commuting on bikes. Right now, it's nearly 50% of every people moving around the city every day is going by bike, which is really changing the city, and there's less car traffic and less, in a way, also public transportation as well. So the city is faced with a new challenge, that is to improve the capacity for bikes in the city. And projects like, for instance, this bicycle bridge is new elements to the urban tissue of Copenhagen. And these elements are maybe also becoming city icons for the future as well. And former big streets in the city are closed down on Sundays. And this was former a main street in the city. And the city changed, for instance, they made a broad pedestrian walk, really wide bicycle lanes. And this is what is left over for car traffic now. So this street profile is actually really interesting to look into, that now the kind of priority is pedestrians, bikes, and what was former really a wide street is just a very narrow street for cars, as you can see here. So this was a little bit about Copenhagen and actually, in a way, the city which we, in a very fortunate way, have been able to work within the last 10 years. And I will show you a range of different projects which works with infrastructure, which works with how culture can become a social engine, which works with large scale planning, and also how, in a way, transformation of existing building structures can become a resource. So there's a set of themes embedded into the different projects I will show you. The first one is what Lawrence explained is it's a station we won a competition for in 2008, which is the most busy station in Copenhagen. There's 250,000 people commuting through this space every day. And in a scale of Copenhagen, it's a really busy place. I know regarding comparing to London, it's a quiet place in the city, but in Copenhagen it is. And this is also what is happening in the city. It's not just on sunny days people, they bike. This is also like how we are doing it in this month when it's snowy. That's the way to get to work. So this is not just a recreational thing. This is an everyday tool to commute in your city as well. The station is located in the city center of Copenhagen, and you can see this is the density of bicycle density of the city, and this is really where everybody day it's a node where everybody is crossing through as well on their bike. It's also of course a station where there's a metro, regional trains, and metropolitan trains meeting at that place as well. And this was also the first underground station in Copenhagen, a very innovative thing at that time. A beautiful urban space was generated on the top, and it was really a vivid place in historical. But over time, it became more a really infrastructural node where, in a way, buses, taxis, car parking, bicycle parking took over all the quality of the public space and ended in this kind of really kind of infrastructural node without any kind of free space for pedestrians, bikes, or the, you can say the plaza submerged from the surface at the end. And this is quite a funny picture we took before we started the transformation of the station. In Danish, this says, it is not allowed to park any bikes outside the parking facility here. And there was like bikes all over. It was like a huge chaos as well. So what we did was that we started to kind of look into how people, bikes, and the whole flow of the site worked. And a smart way is actually, when it's winter, you can really see how people move on sites. And it's not really that we, as Homo sapiens, walk from A to B, we always take the shortest way. So we actually figured out that there was some really, really certain path on this site, which was obstructed by buildings, bicycle stands, bus. So it didn't really work that place. So what we did as a starting point for this project was that we started to register the flow of walking, people biking, and base the whole design on this kind of flow. And we made these kind of islands for interaction and kept the rest free for a fluid space. So we moved the street to one side so we could liberate a big kind of urban plaza here. And here you can see this kind of fluid space. And then we have canopies or roofs, which is guiding the entrance to the underground station. And then you can see this is the bike stands on the plaza as well. Here you can see it in a bigger detail. So in a very simple way, with this kind of diagram of the flow, we created this kind of organic fluid space of station buildings marking the entrance. And then you had this kind of no backside, no frontside space as well. And each canopy marks its entrance to the underground station. And suddenly again, we kind of regained the plaza and the urban square of the city back again. And then we had these kind of plates of a positive shape marking the entrance to the station. And then here you can see the more fluid space. And then we had the negative shapes where we, in a way, as a topography, mark where you could park your bike. Bikers are anarchistic people. They just park their bike everywhere. And this was a huge challenge in a nearly, I would call it a German way. How could you organize these kind of Copenhagen bikers so they would organize their bikes on this station? So we made these kind of topography which marked the bike parking, as you can see here. So this was in a way how it works. And then we marked it and organized the bikes into these kind of islands for bike parking. Each stand has a solar panel, so there's like 3,000 individual lights enlightening the space in the evening. And here you can see people just having an overview of finding your bike among 3,000 bikes on the station as well. He looks like he's lost somehow. So here you can see the new plaza. You have an overview. All the bikes is a little bit lower down into the topography of the plaza. And suddenly this vivid infrastructural chaos node was turned into a new city plaza again. And it's more a new urban square of the city rather than it's a station, and it's based on buses, bike parking, etc. And here you can see the kind of urban life coming back to the station as well. Just adjacent to the station here, we have been involved in the largest square in Copenhagen. It's called Israel's Plaza. Why I actually still really don't know, but this plaza is actually the largest urban square. And up here there's a food market, and then there was this square here. And historically, this was the main market square in Copenhagen. This was where all the farmers came into the city and sold us vegetables. And it was really a heart in the city, a vivid heart. But during the 50s and the 60s, the car entered the logic of the city and in a way took over a lot of plazas and urban spaces of the city and conquered them into parking spaces as well. And what we did with this project was in a very simple way to put all the cars in a parking basement and actually reconquer again this plaza for urban interaction and urban life again on this space, as you can see it here. And what we wanted to do is really to create a diversity of urban activities. There's a basketball court, there's these kind of topographies, which is wonderful for skaters, but this is also where you can sit and eat your lunch during a weekday. So in a way, we created this urban carpet and in a way put it over the cars and created a new kind of public quality in the city, again, as you can see here. It's also a schoolyard for two schools. So during the week, it's like where there's like 800 small kids playing on the plaza, and it's used as a schoolyard as well. So this was the historical kind of activities, and now it's actually back in the city again in a different way, as you can see here. And what is really interesting, I think, as an architect, that is that you design something and you build it, and then you give it to the city, so to say, and then it gets its own life. And I think some of these new medias, for instance, Instagram, it's so fantastic to go and see how things are working. You can really see if people are enjoying it or people are writing something bad about a place. And this is really, this is really cool to see that this plaza is really becoming a part of the identity of the city again. And it's a Copenhagen place where the everyday life is taking place in the heart of the city. I just want to briefly show you the next generation we're working on bicycle parking of the city. This is a university square at a newer part of Copenhagen University. And again, here you can see that the urban quality is that all the bikes are just taking over the public space. And then you have a bench, and she doesn't look super happy about like the interaction of the place. And again, the anarchistic way of parking bikes. And here we introduce bicycle hills that we actually create a new topography where we integrate all the bikes into a new urban landscape, as you can see here. So we have created this kind of a three-dimensional topography, creating a 100% accessible plaza or footprint. And then again, we swipe all the bikes under this kind of urban carpet as well. And just to explain, this is it's more or less £10 million investment on a plaza to actually organize the bicycle parking for the university. So that shows a little bit both the challenges with bicycle parking, but it's also part of that you want to invest in this as well of the city. And that is finalized this summer as well. And here you can see the landscape and the new plaza around the university as well. So that was one theme. That was a little bit, how can we actually change infrastructure in our city into new qualities as well? The next theme is a little bit like how transformation is a resource within our, in a way, profession. I think we should actually, when we work in the city, we should always see if it's the prioritize should always be if there's a quality in the existing structure, we should see whether we can transform it rather than just taking it down as a, in a way, way of just dealing with the city. Take it away and then we build something new. And that is actually the saying that one man's trash can be another man's treasure. And I think we as designers have to guide towards that there is potentials or that there is in a way a value represented in something many people just see as trash, as, oh, let's just take it down and build something new. This is, for instance, an old shipyard hall in Copenhagen, which just with smart design became the stage of the Eurovision Song Contest. So this is just within a month you can transform this to the heart of all the TV viewers for Europe for one day. And the other project I want to show is an old silo in the harbor. And again, with the idea of rather transforming than taking it down, you can turn it into a new value for the city and also for your client. This is a part of the Copenhagen Harbor, and this is one of many, many silo complex where you have store corn. And this was how the facility looked 5 years ago, and it's part of a big urban development of the North Harbour into a new city district of Copenhagen. And we won the competition of this master plan, and we really wanted to keep these industrial monuments and say that there's a representation of a value here, both culturally, historical, but also value-wise in a way. So we wanted to keep them and point out that they could be transformed into something new. And the project I want to show is actually a transformation of the one of the largest silo structures into a housing project and a gallery and a restaurant on top as well. So the silo is this amazing concrete monument or sculpture designed for storage of corn. But it's also this kind of amazing, just amazing piece of engineering as well. So this was how it worked. You have a machinery tower, and then you have all the tubes with corn, and this is where you load. And if you walk into these structures, it's a fully casted concrete building with these amazing spaces, as you can see here. Beautiful ceiling heights and amazing concrete craftsman work as well. So what we did was that we persuade a very good client, which we have been working with before, that he could, if he would invest in this and buy the silo, we could convert it into housing and make a profitable project out of it as well. So what we had to do was actually to work with this kind of beautiful concrete canvas and turn it into something new. So we had a public program in the ground floor and housing in the middle and a public program in the top floor as well. And what we did was to give the new silo a new skin with large openings for the housing on the inside, but also giving it a new kind of coat or dress which could insulate the concrete structure, but also in a way preserve the concrete structure on the inside as well. So we actually could start working with these beautiful spaces I showed before and create amazing flat typologies as well. So this was how it looked, this beautiful concrete canvas. We had a huge problem because we actually loved the building as it was. So we, in a way, it was like a love story which had a set of setbacks in the process somehow. But we came up with this kind of a steel facade where, in a way, we both wanted to make a heavy building which represent the concrete building as it was. But of course, we wanted to have a very transparent building as well to create amazing lighting conditions and viewing conditions for the flats as well. So this was the transformation of the building. It is kind of wrapped into these kind of very large modules, which within 72 days was mounted, and then the building had its new raincoat on. And here you can see some of the details. And in a way, the geometry was nearly like a piece of textile, where you had this kind of a faceted geometry where both balconies, windows is just part of one continuous skin as well. Here you can see some of the detailing of the building. And if you go on the inside, this kind of different floor heights and these tubes gave a lot of different possibilities of doing different flats, from small flats to very big flats, as you can see here. And this is one of the main details of the building, that you cut in, we cut out these huge windows into the existing concrete, and then we put the window frames on the outside, so we have this kind of frameless window towards the view of the building. And this is some of the flats, how it ended up before people moved in. Beautiful spaces, and it really reveals the history of the concrete as well of the project, as you can see here. This is the lobby of the building. We wanted the building not only to be this kind of a private, isolated building for, in a way, rich people buying a flat here. We also wanted to do an urban gesture and make an invitation for the city. So as I explained, we placed a public program on the top. Actually, the most expensive square meters became public. So there's a public viewing platform on the top, and there's an open ground level of the building as well. So it's not only a private building, but it's also, in a way, a gesture or an urban invitation to the rest of the city. So down here, there's an exhibition gallery where we, in a way, still in a very modest way, renovated the building and revealed the history of the ground level of the building. And on top, we placed this kind of a transparent lighthouse or glass box, where we could kind of utilize the beautiful kind of view of the whole city. And this is our design of the restaurant, which just recently opened in the city. And there's also a public viewing platform where you can just go up in a public elevator and go up and have a view of the city as well. So this project was really, and I don't know if it's funny, but this is the most expensive flats being sold in Copenhagen, and they were quite quickly sold out. So our client, he also earned quite a lot of money on this kind of piece of trash by risking the solution of a transformation rather than building something new as well. Another transformation project is, in a way, on a larger scale, where we, in a way, use culture as an urban pioneer. How can you actually kickstart an urban development of an area in the city? This is, you can say, a suburb city to Copenhagen, but it's a very old city. This is a small city with 50,000 people living in the city, but it's a city where the Danish Viking Ship Museum is located. This is where the cathedral with all the kings and queens of Denmark is buried. And it's also the place where the largest music festival in Scandinavia is taking place every summer. So it's a quite famous city, especially for its culture as well. And what the city wanted to do was to, in a way, develop the city in its outskirts and create a connection from the inner part towards this kind of festival site, which is a really important site during the summertime of the city. So the city bought an old concrete factory and wanted to make urban development of that site. So this kind of old concrete factory where they built concrete elements was this kind of deserted wasteland or post-industrial site. And we were invited to kind of come up with an idea of how to regenerate the first step of the urban development by looking into a site of this. And again, I think the city anticipated that we would probably just tear down all this old crap and come with a smart new suggestion as well. But the first step in this development was, in a way, to say all these halls can be utilized by creative people, organizations, artists, events. So we said to the city, you should offer this to the local community with a very cheap rent that they could start to move into these halls and start to utilize them and actually start a bottom-up development of the site. And a lot of kind of events really rapidly happened in this site, and the site became a place in the city very quickly. Then the next step was to create the first kind of master plan and development plan where a new rock museum for the Danish music culture and event culture was the main anchor point of the development as well. And here you can see the existing site, and the first actually new building being built is a museum which the city invested in creating this kind of urban pioneer at the site as well. And we didn't want to tear down these halls, all the kind of activities we wanted to keep. So we said we could very roughly renovate these halls and then build a new iconic building, creating a new kind of notion of the place as well. So this was the project to, in a very simple way, renovate these buildings and then adding this kind of pling-pling piece of architecture, whatever you can call it, but a very kind of strong building with a very strong identity. The museum is not just a museum, but it's a museum representing Danish music history, and especially rock music and the whole kind of culture surrounded by music. But it was also a culture house as well. It should be a very lively museum and a very informal museum. And this was some of the inspirational images we had. Like rock and roll is really about having a glittery belt, but also rough jeans on. And it's about both being rough and in a way very kind of authentic, but also being a little bit pling-pling as well. So this was actually what we wanted to keep, the kind of roughness, but adding this kind of really new piece of architecture, setting the stage for something new happening at the site again. We created this kind of canopy or outdoor stage where today there's a lot of concerts and urban activities going on the public space at the museum, as you can see here. And also guiding a quite kind of a generous entrance to the small museum as well. So to be quite honest, we wanted to do a piece of architecture which had this kind of selfie effect that people really wanted to travel there, see the building and actually activate this new area of the city as well. And here you can again see the kind of the architecture of just very kind of, in a way, sensitive, renovating the existing concrete halls and then adding this new piece. This is from, this is a very important place of the museum. This is the bar or the cafe where we casted a bar in concrete, and this is part of the old halls, as you can see here. The entrance is not just a museum lobby, this is also a culture house where there's events going on. And in the box on the top is this kind of black box where all the exhibitions are taking place. So we have a really kind of formal museum up here, and this is a very active part, which is in a way more this kind of urban living room, so to say, for the city. And this is what is going on. Again, there's concerts, events, as well as being a museum lobby, as you can see here. But what I think super interesting is that we thought this place would be for young people. It would be this kind of a pling-pling place where people, especially the younger generation, would go. But what actually have happened, and that's super interesting, I think, is that it's the majority of people spending their time there is actually older generations, people which was young in the 60s, Woodstock and all the festivals. They are hanging out at that place now, and that is becoming the new urban living room rather than people of my generation and even younger generation as well. And that is something I think our client or us at all didn't anticipate, and they think it's super cool to go here and hang out and speak about the past and have a feeling of rock and roll, so to say, as well. And here you can see some of the detailing of being a very kind of rich, warm, detailed place as well on the inside. So now the city of Roskilde, of course, have their very cultural monuments, but they actually managed by starting up a new urban development of a quite big industrial site with this pioneer project to kind of kickstart this this cultural identity into a new urban plan as well. To continue with that, in the office, we have been able, or been again in a way fortunate to work with cultural buildings, but at the same time, looking into how libraries or culture houses can actually help a neighborhood to heal or create a new, in a way, social meeting point in different kind of neighborhoods, which is maybe struggling a little bit. And I will show you one example. This is in a way that our libraries have been having a challenge. The idea of the library of where you go and rent a book and then you go home and read it is outdated. The future of the library, or how you should perceive a library, is a multifaceted building where there's a lot of different activities. A real urban living room where you just want to go out and hang and gather knowledge or have social interaction as well. So that is a paradigm shift in the understanding of public libraries. But what the city of Copenhagen is doing is that they are actually investing in cultural buildings or libraries in areas which is having socially challenges, which has a high rate of unemployment or high rate of criminal rates, that they believe as a city politics to invest new libraries and create an urban living room which is for everybody is actually helping to kickstart a positive development of different urban areas which is facing different challenges as well. One library which we did some years ago is located in a very diverse neighborhood which is having a high element of unemployment, a high element of crime as well in this kind of area, but a super beautiful and very interesting area. And what we wanted to do with this building was actually in a way to celebrate diversity in a building. And that, how do you actually do that? How do you make a building which is welcoming, which is actually embracing all kinds of people, all kind of from ethnical groups, but also how do you make a building which is for all generations, which is for the smart students, but also for the homeless. That was in a way our vision when we formulated the building. The project was a transformation of an old factory into a culture house and then a new library and the combination of the two. And what we did was actually to say that a library is in a way like a stack of books or different environments which you compel into one building as well. Don't look at the titles of this collage, it's just, REM is not the biggest one, or he is maybe probably, it's, we should update this drawing actually, I don't know with what, but so this was in a way this kind of very programmatic answer to how to organize a library. So it's this kind of stack of books or boxes, and inside each kind of golden box there's a very curated world of an interior which is actually guided towards some different activities or groups of people. And on top there's a hall where you can have events, lectures, concerts, whatever. And in the middle where you have the glass, you actually have the more flexible library functions with books as well. So this is the old factory, and here you have the new building in front and the new kind of public space in front. And in between the old building and the new building, we created this kind of extension of a streetscape. So this is actually just working as a street. You can go into a cafe, you can grab the newspaper, and you can just go and read your newspaper, and you can buy a cup of coffee if you can afford that. And then you can stroll up to the different levels of the library. And inside each box, there's a different function. There's a kids' library, there's like a youth library where the young people of the neighborhood, they can get help for their homework for the school. In the afternoon, there's robot workshops. And then there's the adult library where you have literature, and then you have the hall on top, which is a flexible space for all kinds of events. So if you look into these worlds, you can sit outside here and drink your coffee, and the kids can play inside here. And the kids' library is this kind of a Lego world where you can move the boxes around and you can find books. It's this kind of a green cave of multi-flexibility, as you can see here. This is one big table in another where actually the young kids of the teenagers, so to say, they hang out in every afternoon in this space here. And this is where you can go and find a book and in a nice way just sit and read the first chapters of the book as your own kind of living room. And that is really fantastic. And the hall, it's so vivid there. There's always activities going on during the whole day. The library opens 9 o'clock and closes at 11 o'clock in the evening. And there's a lineup every morning for people just waiting to get in to get a seat of the library as well. So this became a new kind of urban living room and a new center of a neighborhood which didn't really have a identity where people could meet as well. This is completely fresh pictures, and it's something we opened last month. That is a house for all the volunteers working for the Danish Red Cross in Denmark. There's more than 30,000 people working as volunteers for the Danish Red Cross, and we were commissioned to make a building for all these people and make a user involvement process that they should be part of the design of it. It was a nightmare in a way, but also super interesting. How can you involve such a large range of group of people into agreeing on what should a house for them be like in a way? This is the location of the house. This is on a quite formal street with some kind of formal institutions. And this is where the Danish official Danish Red Cross administration is located. And then they wanted to build this house for all the volunteers in Danish Red Cross. There's really a level here. Either you are hired by the Danish Red Cross and they have a president and a general secretary and they very formal, and that was their building, and then all the volunteers, they were giving a new building in front of this house. So this was, and it's amazing to work with these people. It's fantastic to meet so many dedicated people just wanting to help somebody else. It's been a fantastic project. So this was the formal headquarters of the Danish Red Cross, beautiful Scandinavian functionalistic building, and they only had this piece of land in front, a small garden with magnolia trees and a small parking lot. And and the building was given by a Danish foundation, so it was like a donation, all the money was given. And they said, how should we organize a building on like 800 square meters for the volunteers on this side here, which was very small, and it was a heritage building, so it was a little bit really difficult to kind of organize. And what we did was to create this kind of urban couch or urban staircase or urban plaza, where we said we are only touching the historical building in one point. And then we created this kind of landscape, which is a new kind of a south-facing staircase or couch where people can gather and meet not only people from the Red Cross, but it's a new public space in the city, as you can see here. So we placed, in a way, not a building, but even in a way, I would call it a more a new public space in front of the Red Cross as well. And underneath the staircase, as you can see here, we dig down the building a little bit. There is this kind of huge space, but also smaller spaces where people working at the Danish Red Cross, they can just go in. There's events, there's meetings, there's kind of congresses going on in this kind of very open bottom-up building or open space where there's a tons of activities going on at the same time under this kind of plaza we generated as well. And here you can see some of the smaller spaces underneath the staircase, where you have smaller niches. And what is really cool is that if you're from the north, the Danish countryside, and you work with the Red Cross, you can actually bring your sleeping bag, and then you can just hang out and sleep over in the building as well. That was a wish from the volunteers that it should be an open place 24 hours a day, and if you want to sleep there, you can just sleep there as well. But we in a way fail because it's not so long, these niches, as it was intended to. So we had, but that's how it is. But this is again something, if you take or occupy space in the city for a new building, it should bring something more to the city, so to say. So what is the added quality if you take a space in front of a heritage building and you want to build a big, or you want to build a quite big new building? What do you do? Do you just take the space away, or can you actually add new value to the city? And the idea is here to really create a new public space, a new plaza or square or south-facing staircase where everybody in the neighborhood can go and sit and have lunch. But it's also a building, so to say, at the same time. We are soon there, so I hope you have a bit of patience. What is interesting of living in the city is that a city is not only for people like us, adults have work and we are busy and we have friends in the city and we get old in the city, but actually a city is also for kids. And I think what is really important working with urban planning or creating a livable city is how can you integrate kids into your city in a way? What is the qualities for kids in your city? And I think that is really a main attraction for, in a way, city politics to create the best conditions for kids in our city and in a way attracting smart people, for instance, moving to your specific city as well. Copenhagen is having, as many other big cities, a huge boom in kids in our city. And how do you actually integrate kids in your city? And of course, there's a history also in Denmark of how actually kids was part of the adult life in our cities in the 19th century. Normally kids was actually working in the factories, then you started to create kindergartens and now actually I think kindergartens or schools are really one of the competitive tools of creating some of the best cities in the world as well. In our research for how to work with kids in architecture, one diagram I want to show is that we figured out that actually, or at least in Denmark, that kids doing weekdays are more in an institution in their like hours they're awake during a day. So they spend mostly of their time when they're awake in a kindergarten or institution, then they're a little bit at home with their parents and then they sleep a lot. So actually, that space where kids are spending their time in a kindergarten is really, really important. What is a learning space for our kids? What is the architecture creating the best possible creative environments for our kids? And I think that's a really good question. Due to the boom of kids in the city are really behind of creating enough capacity for kindergartens. And what some of the politicians do, they make these kind of temporary pavilions, which is not temporary, they become static in a way that they are not, they stand there for 20, 30 years. And this is some of the examples of, I think, really uninspiring environments where we place our kids a lot of our time in that first years of childhood. And we have been involved in a set of kindergartens. And one question in the design when we work with kindergartens is, how can you actually create a feeling of scale and creating an individual space for each individual kid among many of the kids? What they do in Denmark is that they centralize kindergartens into large institutions of 200 or 300 kids placed in one building. And I don't think that's super inspiring in a way to have so many kids together. So how can you also create an inspiring environment? And I will show you two examples of learning spaces or like spaces or architecture for kids. The first one is an institution for 200 kids. So it's a fairly big building. And what we did was actually to say, rather than just building a large building for the kids, we wanted to create this kind of small village. So the kids, they got each an individual house where they could be having a home feeling, so to say. And then we have two common spaces, which is the white buildings, where there's like common spaces for the kids as well. So in a way, it's a quite big building. We wanted in a way to create a village for kids instead. And on the outside, it's a very kind of sharp, nearly a cartoonish architectural approach of how a kid would draw their house in their first years. So it's very simplistic. It's nearly naive in its architecture, but it's also in a way very scaled down and diverse. So here you have the different houses. And on the inside, you have this kind of endless variety of spaces. It's this kind of babushka doll, you know, that if you open a house up, there's even more houses in the house and smaller and smaller and smaller spaces for the kids, as you can see here. So this is a smaller playhouse in a bigger space of one of the group rooms for the kids. And each kid has their own small house. They have their have a nap at 12 o'clock. So they walk into their own special made house so they can have a nap in each house. And here you can see some of the white houses are these kind of common spaces where the kids they meet. And again, they have a small house where they can sit. And there's also outside spaces on different levels for the kids as well. So this was our first kind of kindergarten we made. And what was really cool was that it's been widely published. And then there was this article in the New York Post where they said that this architecture wonder is being wasted on 5 years old kids. And I was really, yes, we did it. That's really what we want to do somehow as well. Another project, and this now we are scaling up. This is a kindergarten, which is nearly for 800 kids as well. That is the biggest kindergarten built in Copenhagen, or actually in Scandinavia. This is the city, this is the Danish parliament in Copenhagen. So it's a very central located kindergarten, which is located here. And it's really like 800 kids. Do you know how many diapers? Like the whole kind of logistic for trash. The in a way the logistic when there's 800 parents coming with their kids between 8 and 9 in the morning, it's pretty chaotic. So it's also a logistic task to kind of solve this as well. So when we started the design, we said we don't want to do it's horrible basically that the city wants to build a factory for kids. How do we deal with that? So we actually said we cannot do a big building and we cannot do this kind of factory. So we said like a dream situation, if you should design your own kind of city, could we actually make a city for kids? Where actually the idea is that we really make the kind of a ghetto, which is based on the idea how kids would love to spend their time in a way. So we developed this idea, and rather making a 5,000 square meter big building for kids, we made a whole city for kids, which had a town hall, a library, a museum, a restaurant building, a fire station, a stadium, a town hall building. So this kind of idea of creating the perfect setting for kids instead. And when we gave in the competition proposal, we thought this is, it's inefficient, it's super difficult to actually build, it's very kind of fragmentized. But actually we won, and this is from the phase, and now it's actually completely finished, the idea of the building. So instead of doing a big building, we created a whole kind of city for kids with a lot of small and individual buildings, and it's actually very rich spatially, architecturally, and it's very kind of diverse, so to say, in its architectural language, and also in a way easy to read as a kid, that you can see each individual house and you can figure out where to go. It's also really funny, in Copenhagen we have this kind of hippie neighborhood called Christiania, which was founded in the 60s, and this kindergarten is located exactly next to that kind of hippie site as well. And they are like soon outdated. They don't really now know how to reinvent themselves 40 years after. So everybody is a little bit laughing of this place. It's more a tourist attraction. But in a way, this was a new answer of creating this kind of diverse, rich neighborhood again. So actually the kids is coming with a new answer on how to create spaces for how to be social, for instance. So this is the main gate for the kindergarten. There's a football field on top, creating this kind of entrance situation, as you can see here. And all the buildings are creating this kind of natural barrier, so it's kind of a, you don't have any fences. The buildings are creating the fence from the playground to the kind of outside as well. And this is the richness of the landscape. This is kind of the fire station where the kids are having all their moon cars parked as well. And this is the town hall. This is where they meet the kids. This is where there's a theater place and stuff like that, in a very kind of simple, again, flexible space as well. What is not up, it's a very rich, in a way, landscape project, which is really gonna, I think, enhance the idea of this kind of a vision of creating this kind of place based more on the principles of how kids would love to hang out rather than how we perceive things as well. There's details where it's only able for kids to go through small doors or other elements, which is really architecture based on the scale of kids instead. This is the museum building where they had workshops and recreational. And they seem quite happy, the kids. And that was, I think, again, as an architect, you don't, in a way, sorry my language, you don't fuck this up in a way. This is really 800 small lives you are having in your hands. And how do you make an inspiring environment for them as well? So I'm going there quite often to actually just get a feeling of how it is, how it is working as well. Then Lawrence wrote about, like, speaking a little bit about, like, architectural democracy and processes as well. And I brought one example of a project we did in Copenhagen, which was guided more by the public than the hand of the architect in a way as well. In a way, I believe that we as architects needs to be really good in involving people in the change of our city, that people feel comfortable, safe, and they are in good hands when we are changing and improving our city as well. And not to criticize these amazing architects, but I think in a way as a profession, we need to be fantastic artists and be fantastic architects and be super creative artistically. But we should also, get down in the eye level of people as well, as architects as well. This is just some quotations of some of the best architects. Now they're all unfortunately dead besides Frank Gehry. But actually, I think I brought this, I couldn't help it, now we are in England, that actually Winston Churchill said it very smartly, that actually that we shape our buildings and thereafter they shape us. And that is really, I think, a super smart sentence to actually communicate what is the role of an architect and what why is architecture actually important. It's not only about whether things look nice or not nice, or whether it's a brick building or it's a steel building, but actually it shapes the behavior of how we are being together in a way. Copenhagen is, as London, having super complicated planning processes. It is, in a way, a city subdivided into these kind of local boroughs with its own democracy as well. And there's a whole set of like planning procedures of creating a local plan, which is really good. But of course, it's also challenging if you want to do innovative architecture. And there's a whole group of people which doesn't want to have anything happening, or it should be really low, or it should look like historical buildings built 200 years ago. So we are facing a lot of kind of challenges as architects as well. And this is a project we did in Copenhagen, in the heart of Copenhagen, in the center of Copenhagen, where we actually used the dialogue as a design parameter in the architecture as well. It is a very central harborside development for a housing project adjacent to the restaurant Noma and some very historical warehouses in the heart of Copenhagen. And there was like five other proposals which was voted down by the politicians and especially the local community. It took 10 years of like fuss and crazy things going on to actually develop the site. This is a beautiful project by E.F. and Eckerhardt, but they thought this was like the Manhattan of Copenhagen, and it was voted down. The politicians didn't dare to do. It was also good this didn't happen, but this is a range of the proposals which was suggested and voted down in the city. And then we were involved as architects, and we said we have to break the code of understanding what people are afraid of. So we actually made this kind of involvement group of the local community. And one of the guiding principles of the architecture was actually to do buildings, which was like basically just writing the new buildings into the historical tissue, which was already there, not doing something different in a way. To really set a guiding principles of locking these new volumes into the historical context of the building. And this is some of the buildings, the new buildings, where we work with the roofscape and scaling down the volumes and really creating, in a way, a sensitive gesture to the neighboring buildings, so they couldn't speak about high rises or like overly densely built buildings. So this was a way, and in a way, a lot of different principles we actually developed with the local community for actually finding the perfect volumes. And I tell you, the height, for instance, of this was discussed endless. So it's completely, in a way, sensitively put into the site, but still not looking like warehouses built 300 years ago. It's still, in a way, modern architecture. And the whole kind of, that the community wanted really a public ground level, and that is something I really kind of, that was fantastic that they pushed forward. So there's a public promenade, it's not privatized. This is one important view angle to one of the towers of Copenhagen. So we had to bend down the geometry of the buildings to really keep everything just like in the guide of the people here. You can see this was a really important view for many people of the city. So these three buildings are really, in a way, massaged into the urban tissue of the city together with in dialogue with the local community. And many of them, they love the kind of, how do you actually work with a historical building, but actually do it in a new way. So these kind of heavy new modern interpretations of warehouses was invented as well. This is some of the public promenade of the site as well. And here again, you can see how the roofscape are scaled into the site. Again, this is one of the elements of the site. So this is what I call urban massage, in a way, or that that it's like where you, as an architect, both draw with your hand of the architect, but you also are holding the whole community and a whole bunch of people in the hand and are kind of comforting them that this is going to be okay in the neighborhood as well. This is some of the public passages through the building volume, so it's a very fluid and inviting public ground level. This is the brickwork that we, in a way, are working with historical materials, and this is some of the flats. Two projects left, and then it's okay. I'm sorry with the time. We are scaling up now, and this is our project for the biggest urban plan in Scandinavia, the North Harbour of Copenhagen. Copenhagen is a city which is having a lot of post-industrial sites in the heart of the city, and this is a project for the North Harbour, which is a new city district for 40,000 people and 40,000 workplaces of the city. This is the history of the city. So there's a long, also like London, in a way that it's a harbor city, and it's being a city developed into the sea for many, many years. And this is actually the harbor up here, which I'm speaking about. So this is the city center here, and this is the biggest industrial harbor site, and that is the kind of the transformation from industry to a new urban district. And what we did was in a way to make this kind of urban archipelago of a set of islands. So it's not really a big master plan where we in a way drew everything, but we made a strategic plan or a development plan where we said we can draw and we can define quite a lot in here, but what is going to happen here, we don't know, and we shouldn't know at the current stage. This is going to happen in 20 years from now. So it should be a strategic plan. So it's just some guidelines how you can develop a city. I think urban planning 20 years ago, you would draw big boulevards and really define a plan from the architect's perspective and believe that you can actually make the perfect city on a drawing, but that's not possible how I see it. So it's more a strategic plan. Where you can actually say, okay, you can start here, and then you develop island by island, and each island gets its own local plan, and it's drawn in the time being, so to say, in its current time and the current demands and the current kind of knowledge you have of making the perfect city neighborhood as well. So on one hand, it's about creating value and landfill and defining new land in the sea. And at the other hand, it's about creating quality at the existing harbor as well. So the plan is about like cutting the existing harbor into a lot of small islands and develop each island step by step, creating proximity to water all the time. And at the other hand, filling up new islands, and then individually you can develop island by island in a small scale, not in this kind of large scale master planning approach instead. This is some of the principles. I will not, but this is one of the principles which there was a lot of fuss about in the beginning, was that we said it should be really slow and difficult to drive in car in this neighborhood, but it should be really accessible and quick to to walk and bike and go and reach public transportation. This was really a political diagram, which was really up in the political, how do you actually do this? But now you can go and see the first kind of district built in a way and see the public spaces and again see the hierarchy between cars and the other kind of mobility elements of our city. And then, of course, we wanted to keep the history of the harbor, and I spoke about this is the silo project before it was built, to actually use and utilize the industrial harbor and its elements as part of the urban planning rather than just taking everything down. And then dividing the plan into these kind of islands with canals, which has a recreational potential, but also just in a way are scaling down the whole district into smaller bits and pieces. And then, of course, we have worked or really worked a lot with all the elements or the spaces in between the buildings, like really defining what is a good urban space, what is the scale of it, and actually defining all the glue between the buildings rather than the buildings as well. And this is one example of a public space on top of a parking house that actually, if you can utilize a roof, you should use it for a public space as well. So this is a year old now already, but it's a district you can start seeing emerging very rapidly as well. And now I'll repeat the pictures. So, but this is what I want to kind of also conclude with this. To work as an architect from the very large strategic planning and understand the logics of politics, time, and actually have, in a way, understanding of how a city is being developed after you are dead yourself, in a way, as well. And then, of course, the knowledge of the scale of planning, so to say, and what is the right tools to guiding towards a good new city plan, and how can you create livability elements in a plan. And then really getting into the detail of the urban spaces, and we have also been fortunate to design quite a lot of the buildings in the plan, so in 2 or 3 years' time, you can really go and experience a new district in Copenhagen from these design principles. Another coming project in Copenhagen is the Paper Island. This is our office is located here. This is the city center of Copenhagen. Again here, this is the Royal Palace. It's not as big as the one here in London, but it's there if you can see it. And this is a development of this island, which is one of the most centrally located development plots in the harbor as well. It's a piece of land which have never been public accessible for 300 years. It's been part of the Danish Navy. It has been storage for salt, coal, weapons, and now the last 90 years for paper as well. So this is a completely centrally located site, but never been public accessible as well. And then 5 years ago, we were involved in a very first step temporary urban development of this site, which was about opening it up and actually creating accessibility for people towards the site. So the idea was that you should have a test phase of 5 years duration to see what is working and what is not working on this site before you actually start planning and actually taking down the buildings and building something new. So what we did was to say we want to invite a whole set of different organizations and private initiatives into these existing paper halls. And very rapidly, the island became this kind of mega hotspot of just a hangout place. There is a street food, there was a really cool art gallery, and our office moved out there and other kind of other creative initiatives. And that has been going on for the last 5 years, and this is just some images of from paper storage. Here you can see how the whole, and within 2 months, it suddenly looked like this. And the street food market became the third biggest tourist destination in Copenhagen last year as well. A huge kind of food market as well. And this was how our office looked before we moved in, and then it was turned into this space. And this is another hall which was turned into a gallery space, and et cetera, et cetera. So utilizing these buildings and halls for public use was the first step in the plan. And then the island suddenly got a public identity, and next step was to kind of develop a long-term development for the island as well. And we participated in the competition, and we won the competition, and I think we would never have won if we wouldn't have had this 5 years of a temporary process as well. We had a lot of knowledge about the site and had a very strong idea what we wanted to do. So actually, this is on one of our sketches in the competition, was that we wanted to re-invite all the activities and the public life back to the island again. We shouldn't do something new. So we said we want to create a ground floor again where we build new big spaces, like new halls on the ground level, where you could have a new street food market that could become a swimming hall, that could be like an event space, et cetera, et cetera. So this was our envision to actually rebuild these kind of rough industrial spaces for the purpose again. And there's gonna be a swimming hall, which is now being designed by King Kukuma, And this is the street food market as well, and other kind of event spaces. On top of the halls, we placed the hotel and housing as well. And then you have this kind of outer ring towards the water, and then you have this kind of a microclimate of a landscape on the interior with a public plaza in the middle. So here you have a plaza, here you have the big halls, and on top you have the housing. So we have this kind of huge green courtyard in the middle as well. This is the public space in the heart of the development, and this is the outer line of the project. And here you can see again the context of the site, very historical kind of old warehouse buildings. And this is the new profile, or this new crown of the island. But what is important, and you can discuss again the architecture, is that we create new halls for, in a way, public life. And there hasn't been a lot of fuss and debate that now these kind of really attractive spaces are being taken away, because there's going to come something new back again somehow. At the end, I want to show now, this was Copenhagen, our work in Copenhagen. And I just want to show you a building we are doing in Germany for Adidas, the sport brand, which is in a way a private organization or company's wish to also create an urban living room for their employees as well. Adidas is, of course, it's the second largest sport brand in the world. There's many clubs, football clubs in London, which is sponsored by Adidas. And Adidas was founded by Adi Dassler, an entrepreneur, which founded the, and he was like a nerd regarding how to really make the perfect sporting equipment. So Adidas culture is really about working with functionality, and things need to be designed for working or performing the best way possible as well. Adidas is located in a very small city called, it's hard to pronounce, Herzogenaurach, which is located 3 hours drive from Munich. So, to be quite frank, it's located in the middle of nowhere in Germany. You have to fly to Munich and then drive 3 hours to Herzogenaurach, for instance. And it's this fantastic picturesque city where Adidas was founded in this kind of village. And in this village, there's two major sport brands, or fashion brands located, which is Adidas and Puma, and it's the two brothers, and they got into a fight and broke up. So the whole city is organized around those two sports brands. And either you are Adidas family or you are Puma family. You don't mix as well. But one challenge Adidas have is, how can you actually attract the best designers and employees of the world to a village in the middle of nowhere in Germany, basically. So they are developing a new strategy for their campus, which is called World of Sports, and they want to create a fantastic working environment for their employees to be able to attract the best employees around the world. So this is the campus, and this is how Adidas is looking now. And this is the future where they're going to invest for, how many is that? 2.5 billion euros, no, sorry, that's 500 million euros. It's quite a lot, a substantial amount of money investing into new buildings. And this is the first phase. This is an office building. And then there was a competition for this building called HalfTime building, which is a meeting place. It's basically an urban living room for the employees. This is where you go and meet. This is where you go and eat. And this is where you invite the big stars, the superstars of Adidas. But this is also the only public open building where you can be as a public guest being invited into Adidas as well. So this is really a meeting point for Adidas. This is the building, the face to the outside. And this is where actually fans, stars, and employees, they meet under the same roof. So this was the kind of initial concept for us was, how do you create a building, an open, inviting building where these groups of people, they can interact as well. And this is really, I was really surprised. Actually, these superstars, they're going to Herzogenaurach to sign contracts or test products. So it's really, when you're there is actually always superstars present on the campus as well. So what we did was to say, we want to make a common big roof where everybody can meet under the same roof. So this is a 12,000 square meter building in one level under one roof or stripes of light. And then it's really open and you can just like drift underneath it, and it's like nearly like a village under one kind of a filtering roof of light located in the landscape. And this is some of the visuals. So you have a roof and then it's really inviting building as well. And when you're under the roof, it really works as more as a building, as a landscape, where you have, this is the canteen where you can meet. This is different kind of conference rooms as well. It's very accessible. And this is some of the meeting rooms. This is the pool room. This is also where the board of directors of Adidas has got. This is the new boardroom of Adidas. This is another kind of conference room. And this is another kind of meeting room. So the whole kind of identity of being part of a low-key sport brand is embedded into the architecture. The building is conceived as a large concrete roof or a huge skylight, bringing daylight into the deep building as well. And then it's floating and are very kind of open and accessible as a nearly like a filtering city structure underneath as well. And here you can see the one end of the building as well. Here you can see all the kind of, it's holded by these kind of black slabs and concrete. And here you can see the elements of the skylight as well. This is from one of the meeting rooms. And then you have this light coming through the building all over. This is the height of the roof, as you can see here. And this is the status of the project, of the new kind of living room for Adidas, which is, in a way, also where the local kids in the school can go and borrow a conference room and they can meet, who should I mention, of a Zlatan Ibrahimovic from Manchester United. I'm a super fan of him, once in a while in this building as well. So sorry for the time, it took a little bit longer, but thank you very much.
Oh yeah. Questions? Okay.
It's about dialogue, of course. So sorry for the.
I'd like to open this up to questions
from you. Oh goodness, I was a little close, wasn't I? But we have a few minutes for it. I mean, Dan has been very generous, but as he's willing. Any of you have questions? Yes.
First, thank you very much. I really enjoyed the lecture. And I have a very specific question about the city kindergarten one. You mentioned at the beginning, you said that like 800, 900 kids, it's kind of a panicking time when the parents come to pick up them. And you said you figure out a way to translate them somehow, and how it actually works. Like, does your design kind of change the way that at 6 p.m. at night, when parents begin to pick up their children, is it something changing or?
No, I think what we introduced is kind of multiple entry structure that I think there's like six different entries to the kindergarten. So there's not this kind of a congestion of parents panicking to pick up their kids. And I think that the whole concept of the small city enabled us to solve some of these kind of practical issues because it's this kind of a scaled down structure as well.
Yes.
I can show it if.
Sorry.
I just want to find the kindergarten.
No, do you want to go for
no,
it?
No, it's
do you
fine.
Want?
Yeah.
Actually, it's interesting what he said about that, because questions about legibility and knowing the building as a user come up. But I've got lots of questions, so I'll just try and keep it to one. Sorry, my name's Jen. I'm from DRMM. And so public space and giving back to the city is quite important to us as a practice. And what's apparent is the space between buildings is almost as important as the building itself. Mm-hmm. And I just wondered, you touched on it with Croyer, Plads, and quite a few other buildings, But community consultation and engagement is so important in the UK, especially when building in London. Like, you can't do anything. Your hands are constantly tied. Convincing clients and local boroughs is exhausting. And when you get those small wins, it's really successful. And I think it's quite a lot of similarities between our practices and making sure that that's of paramount importance. But what are your actual obligations within the sort of Copenhagen democratic built environment society, to say, in terms of what do you actually have to do, put out to the public when, for example, with Israel Plads or with Nordport, what did you go to and say, what programmatically, what do you want? What do the public want? How do you go about that kind of consultation process?
It's of course very different according to what type of program and the location as well, whether it's a public place or public square or it's a building. But in general, in Copenhagen, there's this kind of planning method, which is that you define a lot through local plans, which is this kind of a legal document, which is defining the frame of how you can develop within a larger area. So it's quite rare that it's becoming really project specific, bits by bits in a way. Krøyersplads is one example where the site was so important that you had to define a local plan for the buildings, basically, for that plot. But in general, the city wants to frame in a way bigger sites and think a bit more holistic to the planning. So it's not like a building project here, and then you have a planning process and a planning process for this building or this. But they look a little bit more holistic or on a larger scale to the legal documents of what you can do or what is the frame within a larger area.
Well, we have a London plan, which is constantly being refined.
Yeah.
And we had a new drop that last year, which is, again, quite interesting. There's a huge investment by the city. I think the frustration that's out between two cities is that there seems a real progressive attitude, which I think is fantastic, in Denmark itself, like between yourselves and in Copenhagen and in Aarhus as well. There's real drive for renewal and an appreciation of the existing, which I feel like sometimes here we really battle and strive for. It's really nice to kind of see that it's documented. I mean, we have to go out and produce leaflets and have exhibitions and evenings spent like listening, and certain projects you can do that up to 10 times.
Oh, yeah.
Which is, like you said, it's exhausting, but it's quite enriching as well when you listen.
Yeah.
Well, while we're waiting for other questions to come in, there's one that I have in mind. That watching or seeing your images of playing with Lego reminded me of the a contrast. There's a, I think many of you know a book called Mart Stam's Trousers, and there's an interview with a mid-20th century Dutch architect called Hugh Maskant in it, who was well known for designing buildings that looked really big because they were big. And
he was a great architect.
He was a marvelous architect. And in this interview, he was responding to a kind of constant criticism that he received, that the problem was that his buildings looked too big. And he says, you remind me of my wife. She always wants shoes that are really big and roomy on the inside and look really small on the outside. And one of the things that it strikes me about a lot of the work is that even when you're designing things that have a fairly substantial program inside, and you're working with something where you're trying to maximize the amount of available space you're working with, you're very keen to bring it back to that sense of, it's almost just like we're playing with Lego, and we're making it, you know, look smaller than it is on the outside. Yeah. Now, is that a preoccupation that stems from an architectural tradition, or is it part of the way in which you deal with these kinds of questions of knowing that you're going to have to deal with a public that is inclined to want to retain a sense of the past and a sense of scale that is rooted in the past, or is it a bit of both?
I think the impact of the work, for instance, of Jan Gehl is something which I think is embedded into kind of our work in the office. That to find the logic of the human scale in each individual project, and there's an urge of figuring out how you scale things down into a human scale somehow. And I think that's something which in a very natural way is something we work with in all our projects in a sense. But it's also in a way to make things a bit more friendly, or less, also in a way, or even more a commercial way, to in a way persuade people that the impact of a new building in a neighborhood can become really good, but you have to explain why it's not too big, or it's scaled down, or it has something more to add than just being a new building. The Red Cross building is a good example, that it's something you can access, it's you can sit on it, and you can use it as a new kind of urban space in the city.
Yeah. There's another question at the back.
Hello. I've been in a question about the Paper Island. I've been there 2 years ago, and it was a wonderful piece of city, full of life.
Yeah.
Basically, you are designing your own house there. How important was being there with your office, and if it could be even a limit for designing your project?
I think it played a substantial role in our kind of design, because it's really a weird place in Copenhagen, that it's just these dull halls. You've been there, and then it's just activated, and it's really a tourist attraction, but it's also really a place where people go and have lunch, and it's very, very vivid. And we saw that we were the first people moving out to the island, and we opened our office the first, and we saw this kind of transformation, how it was just embraced by people very quickly. And I think that was our starting point. We didn't speak about architecture or anything. That was just saying, how can we actually address this issue, that people are going to be so pissed that we are taking away this environment which has been created and has been a big success. How can we actually address this and say, we're not taking something away, we actually want to improve it in a way, or do it in a different way, but it's still going to be there. And that was our starting point. And I, in a way, I think we knew it was so crucial to start on that level, and in that reason, just say we make five new halls again, and it's rough, it's industrial, it's a public base, it's a platform for interaction, and then we place these housing and hotels and all these developer-friendly buildings on top of it. And that, I think that was the key why we won the competition. It was like, I think there was 10 other offices invited.
Thank you.
Elad, anything else?
Thank you for your patience.
Yeah.
I don't know what time it is, but I have a feeling it went quite
well. Perhaps we'll draw to a close and go eat.
Yeah.
Yes. Anyway, Dan, we appreciate the fact that you've been so generous with your time and all the projects you've shown us. It's been really interesting and very informative. Thanks very, very much. Thank you.